just give a quick overview of EdTech at IIT Bombay. So currently I head this program of interdisciplinary program on education technology. It's a 10-year-old program. So we are also celebrating the decade of EdTech, like VNIT is celebrating their Diamond Jubilee. We have 5 core faculty, 15 associate faculty, 2 postdocs and some research staff. Currently we have 15 PhD students who have graduated and about 25 PhD students who are ongoing. Last year, we started an MTech program towards fulfilling some of the need in the country for trained manpower in this area. So we do research in technology enhanced learning environments, we develop tools, we develop MOOCs, and we also engage with government and do consultancy. So a quick flavor of the research that we do, one of them is called technology enhanced learning environments for development of disciplinary practices. And the other one is called teacher use of education technology. So in both of these, we develop models. We come up with, in one, we come up with models of how students learn. In the other, we come up with models of how we can do teaching. And then there are two areas called Emerge, which is basically a playground where we, buy new technology and try to see what educational purpose can be developed through that. So for example, on the left, you see somebody wearing a myo band and playing badminton. So that's, getting feedback on whether the shot was right or wrong. And then we also work in education data analytics, where we use multimodal data to model the learner and determine, why learning is happening, how learning is happening, and so on. Okay. So with that introduction, let me begin with today's topic. So what I'm going to be talking about is to give you an idea of what is computing education research, since this topic may be a little new to many. Then what are levels of education research? So that's a useful framework by which to do this activity. How to do this? What are some methods? How to get started? And what are some opportunities in India? And to make sure that, it's not totally dry, we will try to answer these through some illustrative examples. So my attempt here is not to be comprehensive, but more to be comprehensible. Okay, so what is computing education research? If you look at it, we are all familiar with the idea of computing education, okay, which involves deploying curricula, coming up with courses, teaching the courses. Many of us use LMSs, use different types of education technology, let's say visualizations or, a program, automated program checkers, or even a tutoring system. And many of us are also used to having learning analytics built around that, like taking decisions on the basis of how students do and performing assessments. So these are some of the activities that we are familiar with in carrying out computing education. Then there is the discipline of education research, which deals with how learning happens, what causes students to learn, what is the model that they build, and so on. So this draws from the disciplines of learning science, cognitive science, educational psychology, research methods of social sciences, and a lot of allied disciplines. So what computing education research is about, as many of you would have guessed, is an amalgamation of both these areas. So it basically brings the education research ideas into the CS topics and courses. So one of the primary requirements is that, we try to understand how students learn computing, why are they, where are the misconceptions, why do they have these misconceptions. Then there are areas of designing learning environments. So learning environment could be a classroom environment, or it could also be a online environment. But the key here is to design it based on evidence, conduct experiments and design the environment based on evidence, not simply based on one's intuition. Then we can create EdTech interventions for computing education. So this could be at different levels, it could be at the college level or at the school level. And like I mentioned, so all of this is driven by effectiveness studies and also evolving theories of how the learning happens. So broadly speaking, this is not an exhaustive list, but this is a broadly speaking, this is the idea of how these two computing education and education research come together in the area of computing education research. So now, if we look at this concept map, so in 2020, so there's one conference called Computing Education Research Workshop. So ICER 2020. In ICER 2020, there was a paper which actually did an analysis of all the last 15 years papers in the key conferences in computing education and did a keyword analysis. So the size of the keyword, as you would have guessed, depends on how frequently that keyword occurs. And the color is some grouping of keywords, as well as the links between the keywords is, you know, which two keywords are connected to each other. So as you can see here, the introductory programming, so there's been a lot of focus on introductory programming, you know, how students perform, are they learning programming concepts and so on. And then let me just zoom into it also. And then if you look at the next big box, you know, there's a lot of work around assessment. Work is there around computational thinking, and a little bit of work is there on software development, software engineering, you know, how to create software engineering courses. Then an entire area of, you know, how to get people to do programming that's different from programming courses. Okay. So there's some work on high school students, teaching them recursion, teaching them computational thinking. There's some work on games, algorithm visualization. And then there's some work on student engagement, dropout, and so on. Okay, so this is predominantly the broad themes that people have been focusing on. Now, this does not mean that these are the only themes that are there. So there are other themes which people are yet to get going with. Okay, so let me just unzoom this properly. Okay, so here's another view. So this is a view wherein the learner is at the center. So here we engage with different learners with multiple perspectives. So each type of learner is represented by this oval. So there could be learners who are CS majors. There could be learners who are actually CS teachers, you know, who are now trying to create MOOCs or, you know, go ahead. Then there could be learners who are CS non-majors who are trying to pick up some CS courses. Many institutes actually offer a minor program. And then there is the school segment, which is K through 12, where we talk about topics like science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics. So in all of these, again, there are three different axes along which we can view computing education research. So the three axes here are, you know, if you look at the legend, one is cognition, which is basically what are they learning, how they're learning. So if you look at that, you know, there are topics like problem solving skills, you know, coding and software design, computational models, and so on. Then there is another axis along which we can look at it, which is how it is situated in the community. So which is about interests and passions and so on. And finally, there is the critical inquiry angle, where they're talking about, you know, topics like social justice, agency. Agency means how I want to develop as a professional in the area. And then there is gender and enrollment. So these are all different types of questions which can be asked for pretty much all the learner groups. But in this figure, we have just tried to give it as a representative set of examples. Okay. So what I will do now is I will talk about one of them and then dive into some examples. So if we look at CS majors as the area, okay, so one aspect is to emphasize skill building and, you know, competencies which are useful in college and future careers. So as CS teachers, we are very familiar with this aspect, right? We all our courses are oriented towards doing this. So the obvious example is coding and software design. Of course, there are also other examples, theory courses, proofs, and so on. So this is all geared towards building of skill in that area. Then the next petal, so to speak, is about activities of personal interest, where they can join groups and communities. Like, for example, join in open source projects, GitHub, free and open source software, create something, contribute to the committee, community, and so on. And the third aspect is where they can be engaged in personally relevant social issues, like ethics or, language issues or, some of the diversity that is prevalent in India. So these are some areas in which we can engage in computing education research with CS majors. Here are some examples. So these are some examples that are from our group at IIT Bombay. So one of the things that we have done is, teaching learning of troubleshooting of networks, software design along various at various levels, evaluation of designs, knowledge integration. So these are all topics that we have dealt with. I'll talk a little bit more about them later on. Then in terms of interest, we have dealt with topics like tinkering, how to nurture tinkering for school students as well as college students. And then in the critical inquiry area, we've dealt with questions like, how to teach scaffolding to how to teach programming to vernacular medium learners, or even determining, why are learners opting for CS, and so on. So this was one idea of how we can go into one of the areas. So there are other slides here, which I will not go into great detail. I'll just do one more, and then I'll skip a few slides in order to get to the examples. The slides are still there for the sake of looking at it later on. So when we talk about teachers, again we can talk about training teachers for various purposes. Like one aspect could be to how to create MOOCs. We can do online training, and then there is the notion of creating communities of practice where teachers can come together to create question banks or concept inventories, or teachers collaborate across multiple institutional studies. And then it could be that we also can train teachers to do action research in their courses. So a lot of these, generating models for how to do teacher training effectively, a lot of these comes under the purview of again learner-centered computing education research. Okay, so these are again some examples. Like CS Pathshala, of course, is a very good example of this teacher-focused computing education activity. And then there are like online courses that we have created, and so on. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to skip the next two views, the non-majors views and the K through 12 view, and instead go to the question of, okay, so all of this is there. Now, how do I get going with this type of research? So one framework which is useful for carrying out such research is called the levels of inquiry in engineering education. Okay, so these levels of inquiry actually is from this resource that is listed at the bottom of the slide. So in level zero, you're basically teaching as taught. As taught as in typically the 20th century model where its lecturing is predominant. In level one, the teacher becomes an effective teacher and teaches using accepted teaching theories and practices. So I'll shortly give an example of all of these. So right now, this is just for you to get the broad overview. So in level two, it's a scholarly teacher who actually assesses performance, makes improvements, and does some data-driven activities. In level three, which is actually called the scholarship of teaching and learning, or scholarship of learning and teaching nowadays, the teacher engages in educational experimentation, shares results, there is some generalizability that comes in. And in level four, the researcher and the teacher are actually seamlessly going back and forth, and the teacher conducts educational research, publishes archival papers, and also deals with the why and how of learning. Okay, so now what I'll do is go through these levels quickly through some examples. So in level one, the teacher uses accepted teaching theories. So one example is this demystifying course that I've offered on the Swayam platform. So in this, we use a lot of active learning strategies. So think, pair, share is one particular active learning strategy, which has been known to have, you know, useful benefits in the classroom as well as also in, you know, some sort of online context. So we use that. Then we use algorithm visualization. We use analogical problem solving. So these are all ideas that we actually simply deploy in the course. So many of us as teachers have these ideas, right? We feel that, yeah, okay, for this topic, maybe I'll show a video. Or for that topic, okay, let me make the students do some computation on their own and, you know, share it. So these ideas that we come up with on the fly for being effective, these ideas fall in level one. So what we are doing is the only level of feedback that we are getting is, you know, occasionally you might ask students after the class, you know, did it make sense or, you know, is there any feedback? Or we might look at what have students said in the course evaluation form. So there's typically not much more evaluation of these strategies, and we are generally deploying them based on intuition. So that's the level one. So here's another example of, you know, carrying out think, pair, share in a large CS 101 class. You know, so think, pair, share basically means that, you know, for 2 minutes, the individual thinks individually, and then for another 2 minutes, they discuss with their neighbor, and then subsequently, they share their responses to the entire class. So this example is for predicting the output of this particular program, and it shows, you know, how the think phase, the pair phase, and the share phase work out. So there are many such ideas that we implement in our classes almost routinely at level one. So then when we move up to level two, what happens is we take the same ideas, but we can investigate them a little more thoroughly, a little more in detail. Okay? So we assess performance and we make improvements. So evaluation of performance is not simply through the exams, but also through ideas like, you know, observation of what is happening in the classroom, or a student perception questionnaire, or an instructor's interview, and so on. So this example, for example, is from a data structures course, and it was taught by a colleague, Professor Ganesh Ramakrishnan, and the researchers were Deepthi and a few others from the education technology department. Okay, so what we did was ABAB design. So what an ABAB design means is that in phase A, you're doing the activity, you're teaching a topic without implementing think, pair, share. And in phase B, you're implementing it with think, pair, share. And then the third topic, again, you implement without. And the fourth topic, you implement with. So that's the idea of, you know, A, B, A, B. And what was found is that when we use think, pair, share for some topics, the relative gain is higher for those topics. So this paper quoted below actually has the entire detail, but at this point it's sufficient to understand that a simple ABAB design, you know, it's not a experimental group and a control group kind of design. It's the same class. Within the same class, for one topic you're treating it one way, another topic you're treating it the other way, and you can actually come up with some findings. So usually at this level, the findings is focused on how the method worked for that teacher, you know, how it worked for me, for my students. So the generalizability is not such a big goal, and it may work for others, it may not work for others. So in order to get there, what is useful is when we move on to level three. Okay, so level three, which is the scholarship of teaching and learning, the teacher now engages in educational experimentation. For example, continuing with the same idea of think, pair, share. So what we did, so this was a large CS 101 class that I taught. And what we did was, I mean, there were about, I think, a total of maybe 250 students in each batch, I think total of 450 students. And what we wanted to do was, we wanted to see that, you know, what is the effect of think-pair-share in such a large classroom? So that was a new idea to be explored. Think-pair-share was known to be effective in small classes. We wanted to see what happens if we try to implement it in a large class. So a bunch of students and colleagues, we actually went to the class, we carried out observations and used specific research methods like a control study, collected multiple sources of data, you know, surveys, muddy points, in-class observation, etc., in order to come up with this research, answers to these research questions. So just to give you a flavor, what we found was, like, how much student engagement occurs during the think-pair-share activity. So we found that, you know, by and large, during the think phase, there is about, so the first bar is the think phase, the second bar is the pair phase, and the third bar is the share phase. And this color red means that percentage of people are not engaged, and green means, you know, that percentage of people are fully engaged. So if you look at it across different problems, you find that, you know, the green bar is consistently high. So basically, in the think phase, people are engaged for about 70% of the time. The pair phase, they're engaged for about 95% of the time. And again, the share phase, they're engaged for 75 to 90% of the time. So how did we come up with this result? We actually had people sitting in the classroom as observers, and they had an observation protocol. They would note down, you know, every second they'd be looking at a specific subgroup of students. What is the student doing, and kind of code that behavior. So for example, if the student is looking in some random direction, it would be coded as non-engaged. If the student is actually engaged in discussion, it would be coded as, you know, on task engagement. And then we triangulated the data. What we mean by triangulate is to confirm whether that finding is valid or not through other sources. For example, a perception survey, as well as their performance. So this data analysis considers, you know, validity threats, and, you know, there's also a notion of reliability. So for example, in this particular study, we carried out this observation protocol in 13 lectures. And for the first 8 lectures or so, we were only ensuring that our observation protocol becomes reliable and the instrument is fine-tuned. And the actual data analysis was done on the latter 5 lectures. So this is basically about how one can go at a more systematic way of education research at level 3. Okay. And then when we come to level 4, we conduct educational research, publish archival papers, and so on. So on this slide clearly has a lot of questions. And so what I'm going to do is, instead of doing showing you that, I am simply going to play the video of the people who have worked on those questions. So let me just make sure that you can hear this.
I'm Lakshmi. My bio reads mother, software developer, teacher for undergraduate CS engineering students, comic book and meme enthusiast, and a PhD student in computing education research. My thesis is titled Fostering Software Conceptual Design via the Function Behavior Structure Design Framework. The expected outcome of SCD is a solution represented by various diagrams. From our novice studies, we found specific difficulties such as fixation and lack of integration. To alleviate these difficulties, we have designed and developed a web-based learning environment called ThinkNLink. Our solution is based on the FBS design framework. Incidentally, each of the SCD representation corresponds to either F, B, or S perspective. So by thinking and linking FBS elements together, we can help students create cohesive and integrated solutions. Do check out ThinkNLink as well as our computing education blog site. Feel free to connect with me. Thank you.
Namaste, I am Kavya Alse. I pursued my bachelor's and master's in computer science. Now working in the domain of computing education research.
My research is about enhancing computer network troubleshooting among computer science undergraduates. It focuses on building a technology-enhanced learning environment. First, I investigated the difficulties faced by students while solving network troubleshooting problems. Then, based on these difficulties and based on existing literature, a pedagogy to teach network troubleshooting has been designed. A learning environment called FITER has been developed based on this pedagogy. After working with FITER, we found that students identify the usefulness of spending time to understand a problem before actually trying to solve it. And we found that they do a more systematic, evidence-based approach of hypothesis testing during troubleshooting. FITER can be accessed by students and teachers in the given link.
Hello everyone, I am Prajesh Prasad. I am a computing education researcher and soon to graduate PhD student. Prior to joining my PhD, I was a software developer in an edtech startup and also an engineering instructor. I am broadly interested in understanding how students reason with software design diagrams. As part of my thesis, I developed a learning environment called Verisim, which helps learners develop an integrated understanding of different software diagrams like class and the sequence diagram. Findings from my research study show that learners develop an improved understanding of the software design process after interacting with Verisim. Verisim is freely available online and can be used by instructors and students in their software engineering courses.
Hello, my name is Shitanshu Mishra and I'm an EdTech research scientist at IIT Bombay. Among several computing education research projects, I would like to mention one of my initial projects, which was about implementing visual programming environment in introductory programming courses. We evaluated this implementation and we found that implementing visual programming environment like Scratch for first 3 weeks or 4 weeks in introductory programming course, it helps students a lot in transitioning to traditional text-based programming languages like Java. To summarize my overall computing education research experience, I would like to say that it was an exciting journey and I was very lucky to explore, evaluate and design different pedagogies and technology-enhanced learning environments to support students' learning of various computing education subdomains like information security, data structures, etc. To know more, you can visit my homepage at www.shitanshu.info. Thank you so much.
Hi, this is Kapil Kadam. While learning computer graphics, visualization of three-dimensional transformation is still one of the major challenges faced by students. In my PhD thesis, I investigated the impact of mental rotation training on students' computer graphics problem-solving performance, especially the 3D transformation problems. I used Blender as a 3D visualization tool. What we found is that training helps students in resolving their learning difficulties, as well as students who did the training significantly outperformed the students who did not receive the training.
Hi, I am Ashutosh and I am a computer science graduate who has worked in the area of networking. I am also a passionate tinkerer, which is also the area of my research. So in my research, we try to create pedagogies that are based on the idea of tinkering. Using such pedagogical approaches along with some physical objects or simulation platforms,
we try to teach skills like computational thinking.
We use such pedagogies because
they allow the learners to experience the concepts
as they go ahead and solve problems while being situated in scenario. And that is one of the advantages that we see by using pedagogies
based on tinkering.
My name is Yogendra Pal. I am an assistant professor at NIIT University, Neemrana. I have done my doctorate with the EdTech department of IIT Bombay. Before joining PhD, I started working for the benefits of vernacular medium students. As being one of them, I was fully aware of their problems. During the doctorate, I dedicated myself to solve the problems of vernacular medium students that they face while learning programming. The result is a scaffolding framework that allow a teacher either to select English-only medium of instructions or select bilingual medium of instructions to teach programming to vernacular medium students. After the PhD, I started working on improving this framework so that it can also scaffold school going vernacular medium students. And finally, with all the positive results that I get from this scaffolding framework, I started creating content to scaffold vernacular medium students to make them proficient in English language. And now I am working on improving this scaffolding framework further so that it can also be used in scaffolding other academic language learning like French, German, Tamil, Urdu, or even Sanskrit. You can visit my profile page to know more about me and my research work. Namaste.
Hello everyone, I'm Rekha Ramesh. I work as an associate professor in computer engineering department in an engineering college under Mumbai University. I completed my PhD from Educational Technology Department, IIT Bombay. My work focused on assessment in education. Assessment is an integral part of an instruction and it has a profound influence on what students study, how much they study, and how effectively they study. If students are subjected to random and unfair assessment instrument, then it may not serve the intended purpose. The broad research objective of my thesis is how to improve the quality of instrument and how technology will assist in this process. I designed a framework to evaluate the teacher-generated assessment instrument and provide the feedback. Implementation of this framework resulted in the development of Instrument Quality Evaluator IQ tool. IQ measures the quality of instrument in terms of its alignment with the course objective. It provides two types of outputs, a numerical measure of alignment and its visual representation. If you want to know more about my thesis, please visit alumni profile webpage of Educational Technology website.
Okay, so that was some of my students sharing their ideas. I will just go back to the PPT. So what I have been talking about is transitioning across the levels. I'll come back to the slides in a moment. In the meantime, one of my students, Deepthi Reddy, she is actually a college teacher who has herself transitioned across these levels. So I'll play one video of hers and then we will switch back to the slides. Hopefully the video will play this time.
Hi, I'm Deepthi Reddy and I'm happy to share my journey on how I transitioned from a teacher to an engineering education researcher. So initially when I started teaching, that was immediately after my engineering education, and I had no prior knowledge or formal training on teaching learning techniques. So with experience, I understood that which teaching method is more useful for teaching a particular type of content. So the transition happened from level 1 to level 2 when I attended a quality improvement program on effective teaching learning techniques organized by Educational Technology Department in IITB. So henceforth, my focus changed on using more student-centric methods like think-pair-share, peer instruction, or flipped classroom. Then I transitioned from this level 2 to level 3 when I started my PhD in Educational Technology. So where I learned how to read and interpret education research articles, and I did some courses on research methods like educational research methods, research design, and cognitive science or learning theories, and etc. Then some preliminary studies were conducted to evaluate the effectiveness of teaching techniques, like how effective is DPS in teaching data structures course. And so this was in level 3, and then the transition happened to level 4, that is engineering education researcher, when I started working on my own research problem. So one of the problems that I identified that students are not very good in applying problem solving skills when an ill-structured problem is posed to them. So I researched on this problem, like how other researchers have approached this problem, or what technological solutions are proposed in literature, and I designed and developed a technological intervention for teaching problem solving skills to students. And this intervention was rigorously tested or evaluated by conducting various studies at various levels, and we did various qualitative and quantitative studies till we found some findings which can be published in literature, or these findings can be used by other researchers, or they can be used by educationists or instructional designers. So this is my journey from level 0 to level 4, and thank you for listening.
So this is what I was talking about in terms of moving across the levels, and Deepthi has actually said very clearly what happens when you go from one level to other. So I'm just going to skip it. These slides can be just looked at as reference material. So in level 2, you're conducting experiments. In level 3, you're actually sharing the results, also doing quantitative as well as qualitative studies. So I will just now straight away transition to the next question. We've already heard Deepthi about her journey. So now the question is, you know, what sort of methods do you want to use in order to get there? So what are some of the methods for computing education research? So I'll go a little faster here, because anyway, this will be a little abstract. So one of the main thing is that, you know, making claims about effective teaching and learning in computing is different from making claims about computing itself. Okay? So the teaching and learning actually has to borrow methods from, you know, psychology, cognition, education, statistics, and so on. So there are theories of learning which one has to learn oneself. You know, one has to learn about how to do these investigations, how to collect the data, how to choose participants, how to establish validity, reliability, and so on. So here, the theory and the method are very tightly coupled. Okay, so context also plays a role. So what that means is that the generalizations are conditional rather than universal. So this can actually come as a shock to us from computer science, you know, who are used to, you know, single execution and it gives the same answer every time, or, you know, there is a proof for a particular thing. So here it may be that, you know, something holds in one context, it may not hold in another context because of some reasons. So there's a lot of qualifiers which are valid way of carrying out such research. Okay, so to give you a very quick idea, there are broadly three different types of methods. You know, one is the qualitative and the other is the quantitative, and in between there is a mix of both of them. So the qualitative, which is the first row, you know, the goal of qualitative methods is to get a very rich in-depth understanding of a phenomenon. So these are not large n studies, they are very small n studies, you know, sometimes as few as, you know, 3 or 4 students, and you're trying to understand how something is happening, why something is happening, etc. So often they are dependent on field work, interviews, you know, focus group, and the type of analysis that they use is called grounded theory or interaction analysis. So now these terms may be strange for some of you, but, you know, the references which we have in the slides, you know, you can get more about it in case you're interested in that particular type of work. At the other end of the spectrum are your large N studies. No? So these can go from, you know, pre-post or a control group and an experimental group type of a study. So the idea here is to actually test a hypothesis. So once you have a hypothesis, so the qualitative study helps you to generate the hypothesis, and the quantitative study is often used to test the hypothesis. Okay? So, and this uses standard statistical, you know, techniques, inferential statistics, comparison of groups, you know, what is the t-test, and so on and so forth. And in between both of them, you know, when we are trying to understand trends or categories, so that there we use techniques like descriptive analysis, you know, what are the distributions, you know, what is the kind of transition of students, how are high performers and low performers doing across as the course progresses, and so on. So broadly speaking, these are three different types of research methods that you can use. And there are more resources about this on our departmental webpage. So I'll just quickly mention the type of method that we use for designing our interventions. Okay, so the method that we use is called design-based research. Basically, it allows us to go through all these phases. So for example, you a problem. Okay, so let's say I identify that, you know, students are having difficulty in learning how to do troubleshooting. Okay, so then there are two phases. No, one is to look at literature. Now, how is troubleshooting taught in other disciplines? What has been said about, you know, students' difficulties? And then there is also the notion of analyzing how do experts do this, how do experts do troubleshooting, what is the difference between when a novice attempts troubleshooting versus an expert attempting, and all of this knowledge of the learning environment. So conjectural learning pathway, what that means is you think that, okay, you know, if I make novices first do understanding the problem and, you know, compare the given network with the ideal network, then they will be able to generate more meaningful hypotheses and so on. So you conjecture a learning pathway and then you create the learning environment. So often a lot of us from computer science, you know, focus a lot on this actual coding of the learning environment. But what I'm trying to show here is there's a lot of things which comes around it, and the learning environment is basically the tool for carrying out the investigation. And then once you have deployed the learning environment, like we saw in one of the videos, you know, then what you do is you have generated a lot of data. Sometimes you have screen usage data, you have performance data, you also have survey data. So you analyze all these data and interpret the results to identify whether desired learning is happening. And one important thing that has to happen here is to be able to extend the theory. So this is what is called as the local learning theory. You know? So how does the design support the learning? What is the learning mechanism? And that feeds back into the research of the community. And that's how the entire field grows of the knowledge about how learning of computing topics happen. Okay, so having said that, I suppose some of you may feel that, okay, you know, this sounds interesting. How do I start doing computing education research? So here, the best place to start really is the computing education blog. Okay, so this is a blog that is an initiative by Prajish, whom you met in the video. So so if you just Google IITB computing education research blog, it will take you to the blog. And from there, there are links to a lot of resources and a lot of different areas. Like there is an entire tab which says how to get started. Then there are books that you can read. All again, the links to these books are provided from the blog, so you don't have to really note them down right now. And there are other blogs like Mark Gazelle's blog and Amy Koh's blog. Both of these are, you know, very famous and very regularly updated as well as regularly referred to. Then there are conferences like SIGCSC, ITICSC, and ICER. These are like three major conferences that happen worldwide. In India, of course, there's Compute and there is T4E, which is the Education Technology for Education Conference. And then there are there is AIED, AI in Education, Learning Analytics, Educational Data Mining. So these are all conferences. Any of these conferences, you know, if you look at the past 3-4 years papers, you'll get an idea of how the field is moving along. And many of these conference papers subsequently become journal papers. So these are the journals in which typically they are published in, you know, ACMT, OCE, Computer Science Education, sometimes also in the IEEE Transactions on Education. So one easy way to do this is to, you know, attend the next session where Shitanshu will be talking about how to design and conduct research studies. Also, many of these conferences are online, so it should be easy to attend them. Okay, one last point about this is, you know, how do we collaborate for computing education research? So typically what happens is that, you know, computing education researchers are in a minority in any given institute. It will be the core research areas which will be in the majority in a department. So the key here is to form the community across institutes. So start with topics that you care about and collaborate with like-minded colleagues. So that helps us to overcome this isolation issue of, you know, I'm the only person in my institute who's working on this. So that may be true, but then there are 10 other people in 10 other institutes who are working on similar topics. And that's how we can create multi-institutional studies. So this is again a topic which will be discussed in the conference later on. So I will not go more into that. Okay, so this is again a link to our website, which provides a lot of these resources, you know, how to do ET research, you know, templates for generating ideas, planning your studies, and so on. So a lot of this will be talked about in the next session. Okay. So now to just for the last few minutes, let me just talk about why do we need computing education research in India? So the question is, you know, how accepted is it as a research area? So the key point there we have to understand is, as Professor Jayant also mentioned in the inaugural, that IBM itself recognizes it. So there is the transactions on computing education, and there are major conferences. Okay, there are several researchers around the world doing this research, and there are many CS departments in the world which recognize computing education research as a meaningful area for them to recruit in and grow their faculty strengths. So for us in India, you know, although we don't have too many departments around the country which are hiring computer education researchers, it's an opportunity for us to be part of an emerging and relevant area. And more importantly, it also gives us a slightly different angle, as we will see on the next slide, you know. So far, we saw that research goals that are of interest to the community worldwide, you know. So how does think-pair-share happen? How do novices approach software design and so on? Now, such goals are, of course, relevant to India. But then in India, we have this the beauty of this diversity. Okay? So because of that, we need different educational innovations. You know? So one of the things that I repeatedly mention is that, you know, when you want to scale a technology innovation, for example, you've invented a new type of mobile phone, and you want to scale it, you basically, all you have to do is to try and reach it out to larger and larger number of people, right? On the other hand, if you look at an educational innovation, that type of scaling does not really work because the contexts differ. So what works in, you know, the American context may not work in the Indian context. In India itself, what works in Tamil Nadu may not actually work in Assam, and so on and so forth. So what we need are, you know, multiple innovations and, you know, a place where all these innovations can be shared and people can actually draw upon this knowledge. And one of the places that we are trying to put all of them together is through these blogs and so on. So these are some of the factors. I'm sure you're familiar with most of them. So I'll not delve into details of each of them. So just to quickly give you an idea. So one is, how does language affect computing learning? So this you heard Yogendra Pal as part of the video about, and his thesis deals with, you know, how do students from vernacular language respond to being taught in English versus being taught in a mix of English and the vernacular language. And then there are also questions like, you know, what factors influence students' choice of computing? How do these factors influence the subject matter? And what do teachers do because of that? And more specific open-ended questions like, you know, how can the access to education be improved? How does it affect people's lives? You know, these are not questions to which I have answers. And these are not questions to which, you know, we even have the beginnings of, you know, how to go about answering them systematically yet. But these are very important questions which we need to ask and maybe discuss in the breakout and, you know, come up with project proposals and investigate systematically. So this brings me to the last slide. So this is the you saw so many people come and talk in the videos. And these are my students, Ashutosh, Lakshmi, Prajish, and Kavya, Deepthi and Shitanshu, who have graduated. So they have all helped and contributed ideas towards making this talk. And there are others in our CS Education Research Group. You know, you've seen Yogendra, Kapil, and Rekha. Ritujit and Aditi have graduated, and they're not included in the videos. The faculty are Professor Sanamurthy and Professor Sashi Kumar. And there are other faculty and alumni and students of EdTech IITB who have participated in different studies at different times, and who all share a piece of, you know, the recognition through this ACM OCCE award. So with that, thank you very much. And this presentation itself is available on my website. If you just Google IIT Bombay and click on Talks, you can download it right away. Thank you. Yes, that's good.